His highly acclaimed tribute to Woody Guthrie on June 22nd at the Berkeley Fellowship, located at 1924 Cedar Street at Bonita. The show starts at 8 p.m., and this concert is a benefit for Save the Oaks campaign. For ticket information, please call 510-841-3493 or go to www.saveoaks.com. I hope to see you there.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 2 p.m. Stay tuned next for About Health.
All right, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore. It's a beautiful, beautiful day. Certainly a surprise from one or two of the days of the weekend, but it looks like things are going well. And I think it's a nice day to sit around and talk a little bit about your health. Today we have a special guest. Our special guest is Dr. James Otis. Dr. Otis has been a chiropractic, especially a neurologic chiropractic, been in practice for 25 years in the East Bay, and has an extensive training in nutrition and a whole variety of different approaches to your health. Certainly a great deal of interest in wellness as well and balance problems. A lot of things that that his training has allowed him to do that is beyond the scope of many healers. So we want to welcome him to our program. As always, our number in the 510 area code is 848-4425. That's 848-4425. Dr. Otis, welcome to our program.
Thank you, Dr. Lenore. I'm glad to be here.
All right, tell us a little bit about, you know, most people know what chiropractic is, but tell us a little bit about chiropractic, but more specifically about your training and focus on neurology and chiropractic.
Great. Chiropractic's been a profession for 120 years, something in that range. Historically, we've helped a whole group of different kinds of diseases, everything from asthma to epilepsy to back pain to you name it. And historically, chiropractic has become more and more known as a musculoskeletal kind of profession. Chiropractic neurology is training us to understand how the musculoskeletal system affects the brain, and in turn, how the brain affects all aspects of our health. Because the brain regulates our blood pressure, it regulates our digestive system, it regulates all of our vital processes. And so as a chiropractic neurologist, we get extensive training in terms of how to understand how the brain is working. And these are largely what we call soft signs, soft medical signs. So we'll look at things like blood pressure right versus left. We'll look at how big the veins are in the back of someone's eye. We'll look at their posture. We'll look at how their eyelids, which eyelid is higher or lower. All of these things talk to us if we know how to understand them. And they tell us about the tone, especially of the base of the brain, how the base of the brain is functioning.
As you evaluate a patient from that perspective, what do you look at differently, say, than with the average healer, chiropractor, as you try to integrate those all of this information coming from the brain? What are the signs that are different for you than there would be for someone else who's practicing without this kind of additional perspective?
Yeah. The major difference is how I think about the signs. So a lot of doctors will take blood pressure. Not many take blood pressure right versus left, or blood pressure when it changes from lying down to standing up. But those are all very significant signs about how the brain is working. And so, for example, routinely I see people come in and the blood pressure is higher by 10 points on one side than the other. And that is a very strong indication that the autonomic nervous system, the sympathetic nervous system on that side of the body is not being dampened appropriately from the base of the brain. So it's a sign that there's an imbalance that we can help. And it is, we do treatment many times, and we'll talk about what kind of treatment I do later in this program. But as we do treatment, instantaneously, the blood pressure equalizes out right to left, often, usually, if it's successful. And that's a sign that there's more integration, more balance for that person, and they'll feel better. They'll be healthier.
And so if you just took a group of people, for instance, use the example that you just given us. If you take a group of people and you measure their blood pressure on one side or the other, what percentage of those people would normally have an imbalance in blood pressure, for instance?
Well, what I consider to be normal is anything within 4 to 5 points difference I'm not concerned about. So it's normal to have some variation right to left. Anything greater than that I consider to be important to address. And in the population of people that come through to see me, maybe 10%, something in that range.
And you can adjust that in some way.
Right, right.
All right, let's talk a little bit about the philosophy of chiropractic and how you've molded it to benefit, you know, your experience and your training.
The philosophy of chiropractic developed as a spinal manipulation, primarily spinal manipulation art. And the nervous system has a lot of input from the spinal structures into the brain. And so it has a strong impact on brain. And there have been various philosophies and attempts to understand how that works. And we've noticed clinically that it's been helpful for people with, you know, like I mentioned when we first started, a whole wide range of issues from lung to blood pressure to digestive to you name it. And we're starting now to understand the neurology of how that works. And it's affecting the brain. There's a strong input from the spine to the brain. But so what I do is everything I look at, I think brain, the nervous system. And we can use a whole variety of different sensory input to affect the brain. I'm using sound I'm very excited about using sound for people with learning disabilities and pain. And I'm using particular frequencies of sound that help stimulate particular parts of the brain. And so that's one example of how I would think about treating a patient. We can also use, there's a group of chiropractors using, and especially people who are trained with neurology, using photic stimulation, light stimulation from different fields of space, upper left, upper right, whatever, to help balance the brain. And getting great results with learning disabilities and different kinds of, also structural issues. People who come through with pain in their back can respond to this kind of thing.
Yeah, let's start there. I mean, most of the time when we talk chiropractic, we're talking about the kind of classic chronic pain issues and muscular issues that chiropractors certainly deal with well, and they deal with other things. Let's talk about your perspective of balance, what that means to you.
Great, great. So the balance system, and there's two things I'd like to cover today about balance. One is what can be causing a balance disorder, and number two, how many different hidden balance disorders affect other aspects of health, and everything from I like to give a few examples. Somebody with urinary incontinence, working with it might be the balance center might be affecting that. Somebody with digestive problems, the balance center might be affecting that. Somebody with anxiety, there might be a hidden balance issue that is affecting that. So there's a whole group of different impacts that the balance system has on other systems of the body. So I'd like to do is start with some of the issues that might be affecting the balance system. Well, why do we have it anyway? The balance system helps keep us upright in the face of gravity. The balance system evolutionarily has been one of the major driving forces for the development of our brain. When, as a species, we started to stand upright, the computational demands on our brain, the brain processing power, the needs skyrocketed, and our brain grew to accommodate that. And that's what allowed us then to start doing abstract thinking and a whole group of things that make us very uniquely human. All of the areas that are really big for humans, the frontal lobes and the lateral aspects of the cerebellum, developed largely out of movement and a need to stay upright. So when a child is in their developmental process, if they don't ever learn to walk, it's very unlikely that they'll learn to talk, because the neurological development and maturation of the brain that walking allows sets the stage for a child to be able to talk. So that's a little bit of a background about why the balance system is so important. Another piece here is that The balance system has a strong impact and interaction in the base of the brain with a lot of the controlling, the parasympathetic controlling mechanisms that go to control our digestion and whatever. So let's go to an example. I think it'll bring it alive for people. Last year somebody came into my office. She was about 35 years old. She had had chronic diarrhea for a long, long, long time and had been all over the country looking for help. And I sent her home with one simple instruction the first night, and that was to balance on her left leg. And I prescribed that because I saw signs that the left side of her cerebellum and the right side of her brain were not functioning as strongly as the other side.
And what were those signs? I mean,
there are a number of different signs. One is how well she could coordinate her eye movement. The cerebellum has a lot to do with movement and coordination.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so how easily she could do alternating hand movements, fine motor skill. Her balance, if she tended to sway to the right, if she could hold her balance, if I gave her a little push one way or the other. So I looked at the signs and prescribed for her, just go home and balance on your left leg and then come back and we'll do some more. She came back and said for the first time in about 6 years, her stools were normal. And that was the way that happened was the balance exercise from her left leg helped to stimulate the balance center in the base of her brain, which interacts with these controlling areas of her brainstem that then affected her digestion. So there are other examples, other similar kinds of examples. Many times children with learning disabilities have some type of a balance issue as well. In essence, one side of the brain will be firing stronger than the other. And so I might prescribe spinning in one direction.
Mm.
So doing a spin to the left will have a very different neurological influence on the brain than spinning to the right. And so many people come in when they have problems, there's an imbalance right to left. Most of the time we look for balance. We want a roughly equal activation of the right and left side of the brain. And if there's an imbalance, there's something that's not going well. So for many children, spinning one direction will be beneficial for them.
Now, how does that extrapolate into learning difficulties and your approach to those and other kinds of things that are not traditionally thought of? You'd have to agree, at least we could discuss it. But when you think of chiropractic, you don't often think of learning disabilities, anxiety, other forms of problems that have to do with balance.
Yeah, that's really true. That's really true. But from another perspective, chiropractors are just so natural to treat this, especially if we know how to, if the person is trained to look at what's happening with the brain. And the reason, again, is that the areas of our brain that are involved with abstract thinking are areas of the brain that grew out of the same areas that help control movement, all kinds of movement, and also the areas of the brain that help control our attention, where we decide what we're going to pay attention to. And where we use impulse and control, where in essence we decide, I'm going to do this, I'm not going to do that. Those are the frontal lobes of the brain.
Right.
And the frontal lobes, they're all about movement, evolutionarily, that they develop from movement areas of the brain. The part of the brain that controls, finally, movement is the motor strip in the brain, which is part of the frontal lobe.
We're talking with Dr. James Otis. We're talking about chiropractic, expanding our discussion a bit over the traditional discussions we've had on chiropractic in the past. If you want to join us, our number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. You know, one of the interesting things about your approach is it does take an additional piece of training, doesn't it? I mean, you didn't just follow the normal path to chiropractic. How'd you get so deep into neurology? What was your training for that?
A fascination with how the brain works is the first one.
Right.
And a second piece, one of the reasons I got into it was I had been interested for years in using sound as a healing modality and seeing some very remarkable results using something called binaural beats.
Uh-huh.
With brain injuries and with learning disabilities, with a whole group of different things, nausea. And I wanted to better understand how that worked. So that was one motivation. And then also to help develop that work more completely. And so I took on an 8-year study program and probably 2,000 hours of study and the whole rigmarole of studying for this thing and going to Florida for this 3-day exam and And so that's what got me started.
One of the things that it's interesting, just to digress a bit, is that I have interviewed people who talked about the secrets of healthy living. And the one thing that they felt was more important than anything else to be healthy as you get older in terms of quality of life was motion. Mm-hmm. Being able to get up, walk around, and to protect your legs, because they were so critical to good health. And that was just physical health. Now you're saying they're critical to just about all
Absolutely.
Aspects of health. And I think too often we don't take into consideration that this is an instrument, an organ system, which is so important
right.
to the
right.
development of everything else.
This is reminding me of a couple of things I'd like to jump in.
Go ahead.
Jump in with. One of them is that one of the best predictors for how long somebody will live once they reach like 55 or 60 years old is how long they can balance on one leg.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a couple different reasons for that. One is that falls are the leading cause of death for people who are 75 or older.
Mm-hmm.
They're the leading cause of accidental death for people who are 65 years or older. And even more basic than that, like we've been discussing so far, the balance mechanism in the brain is tightly controlled with all the other physical, vital, regulatory systems in the brain. And then there's other really great studies. I just saw another study this last week about people who exercise having growth in an area of the brain called the hippocampus, which helps control memory, helps us memory. And it's a very good preventative for Alzheimer's and all kinds of neurological degenerative disease. So I would agree with all these other people you've been talking with that motion, there's nothing more important than motion in terms of keeping us healthy. And that's we have a great deficiency of that today. And we tend to be a sedentary society. And then the other extreme that we often go to is exercising too hard. And exercise, in order to be effective, it really needs to be comfortable. Ideally, exercise helps rejuvenate our body and not exhaust it. And we will get better neurological benefit and greater cardiovascular benefit by exercising in what we call a very easy exercise range. So not out of breath for sure.
Tell us a little bit about how you work with people with learning difficulties, anxiety, and discuss with us how you have come to use sound as a tool.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing that I do is, especially with people with learning disabilities and anxiety, there's a whole group of different factors. So there's my part of this program is to evaluate what's going on in the brain and how that is contributing. So it becomes, I do an examination, and what's happening with that person's brain and how can we best address that. So So the first step is do an examination and find out how this person will be helped. And so my goal is to help the brain function better. And then the person will benefit from support with tutoring. They will benefit from other kinds of social support as well.
And what about anxiety? That's a big one.
Anxiety is often related to, many times there's a high correlation of anxiety with balance system issues. And partly it goes back to one of the most primitive reflexes we have. Every baby, if you start to drop them, they'll have a startle reflex. So there's this built-in kind of fear response about mm-hmm. falling, that if there are aberrant signals into the brain from however those aberrant signals are happening, and I'd like to talk about that in just a second, then the balance centers aren't functioning well, and it can create an emotional response. And anxiety is a common correlate with that. So let's talk a little bit about how practically we could go about helping the functioning of a balance, of the balance system. So we've gotten a pretty basic idea that it can contribute to digestive disorders with the one example I gave, and I can give many, many more about how working with balance can take care of stomach pain or constipation or diarrhea, that kind of thing. How it can affect learning disabilities. So we've covered a little bit of the impacts that like these hidden balance problems can have. So let's talk a little bit about how to treat it. And I mentioned already spinning from one side or another. That's one possibility of how to treat it. Another way to do it is to use neurologically guided body work. And there's a very important principle that happens with our brain, that our brain wants to know what position our body's in. So it needs to have that information in order to make an intelligent decision about how to move. And it gathers that information from a committee of muscles and tendons and joints, nerve endings in muscles and tendons and joints, that send different information into the brain to help the brain make a decision. And sometimes there are biomechanical mess-ups. So the information coming into the brain is garbage. It's confusing to the brain. And that happens when there are adhesions between muscles or in joint capsules. So under ideal situations, if I move my shoulder, one muscle gets shorter, one muscle gets longer. They each send a signal into the brain. One muscle saying, I'm short. Another muscle saying, I'm long. And the brain says, okay, great. I know where the shoulder is. But if there's an adhesion in that shoulder and you try to move it, there's one muscle that says, I'm short, and the other muscle says, no, I'm short too, and the brain gets confused. And it's stressful for the brain, and that affects the balance center. So what we need to be able to do is to understand when the body is sending confusing signals into the brain, and then how to correct it. And the correction and understanding when it's doing it is the really key piece, and then understanding when you've got it corrected is another key piece.
So. All right, we're talking with Dr. James Otis, who's a chiropractic chiropractic with a special emphasis on neurology. I'm sure, as you heard, a substantial resource for those of you interested in the issues we've talked about. We haven't talked about pain or other things that are additional chiropractic issues, but certainly Dr. Otis is available. The number is 510-848-4425, 848-4425. As we call this, Dr. Otis is the least expensive second opinion in town. I don't have the list. I can't hear the people, but I know Christina is first. So let's go to Christina. You're on About Health.
Oh, everybody. It's been a long time since I've even talked on the radio, but I just want to say that I was a victim of head trauma back in September, and it's like 9 months later, and I'm still having quite a lot of head pain on the right side of my brain. And I did get a little relief through craniosacral work and somatic experiencing. And, you know, everyone's telling me it's psychosomatic, and I'm telling them no. But it's amazing, because just walking, the percussion from the ground up to my brain, it's as if the fluid or the cushioning isn't adequate anymore. So I'm just wondering, I tuned in late, but if there's anything Dr. Otis could say about what kind of treatment he would, you know, what approach he would take or what I should pursue.
And Christina, would you remind me, this happened after trauma?
Yeah, I it was pretty heavy trauma. Unfortunately, I was a victim of violence. I had someone hit me on my skull several mm-hmm. times. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty, it was traumatic. And I was in a lot of pain for quite a while, and it started to subside like 2 months ago, and then it lightened up a bit, and then it got worse again. So it's interesting. It comes and goes, basically, but it's never completely gone. Sometimes right. It's just like a band of like a hockey puck, you know, and it's mm-hmm. gone through so many changes since the beginning. It was a lot of migrating pain in the beginning and deep centered core of my brain in the beginning. And, Vicodin was not the only thing that Western medicine or the hospital, you know, people wanted to give me. And I did that for a little while, and it was great. But, I didn't refill those prescriptions because I just haven't taken care of it. You know, I'm just living with it, basically.
Right. Yeah. Christina, did you have any symptoms of a concussion? Did you lose consciousness or have any confusion with your thinking?
A lot of not lose consciousness. I had almost a blackout. You know, I felt my whole brain going under, but I didn't go under. So, mm-hmm. and as far as confusion, I think my ability to deal with life in general mm-hmm. is like greatly diminished, and right. my energy is greatly diminished. But it's also something that I don't know how to say if it's psychosomatic or not. You know, I don't I don't want to label that as much because the pain is real, but it's like just sitting here talking to you about it, it gives me some clarity in my brain. You know what I mean?
Okay. Well, I'd like to first, Christina, say that this is a really common kind of scenario. I hear this kind of story very, very frequently. And there's a couple of different issues that I would want to have addressed with you. Okay, one is just physically what's happening with the sutures in your brain, in your skull. And you've addressed that to at least some degree already with the craniosacral. So I'm going to explain this a little bit so other listeners can get a sense of it. Our skull is designed to move, to have a slight amount of movement. It provides a protective covering for the brain. But it also, every 15 or 16 seconds, gets a little bit wider side to side, shorter front to back, in a way that accommodates cerebrospinal fluid circulation around the brain. And that's very important for neurological function. And so there are pain-sensitive areas of the skull which might be being affected with you. So that's one piece to address, just the biomechanical, how is the skull actually moving, and also your cervical spine. Okay, so that's one. Another issue is, especially having to do with pain, is that your brain might have been injured with a concussion type of thing, or some kind of, just the force of it might have injured your brain. And that what happens in that scenario, In that scenario, we have, I'm hearing like callers being announced. Is that going out on air?
No, that's just coming to us.
Okay. So I'm back to you, Christine. I was distracted there. So the brain, it has a number of important functions. I'm sorry, just saying. Can we turn it off so I don't hear that?
Well, it's... You just heard the one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Back to Christina. So, the brain will be inhibiting pain. That's one of its functions. And if your brain is not functioning well, you're much more susceptible to pain of any type, whether it's from your knee or from your digestive system or from your low back. So that's another piece. Was there a brain injury, and how would we help that? And there's a number of ways that I would go about helping that. One is with specific types of sensory input, including the sound work that I talked about earlier. I've been very pleased with that, working with people with brain injuries. Great. Thank you, Christina.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's go to Amy in Fresno. You're on About Help.
Hi. I relate to Christina's story so intimately that I completely lost track of my problem and question. I was going to ask the neurologist how it's possible for someone occasionally, and this is from adolescence onward, to have ringing in one ear that's so loud that other people can hear it. Hmm. And most of the time, my hearing is exceptional.
Mm-hmm.
What? Then there's another dimension of the problem I discovered only at the age of 64. I don't have curvature of the spine. No, I do, but it's because my left foot is 2 inches shorter than my right. Mm-hmm. I always wondered why I was always standing on one leg. Mm-hmm. Now I know. The other didn't reach the ground.
Well, Amy, let's take the first question first and then come back to the second one.
Yeah.
So it's a very interesting phenomenon, and I wonder how many people have actually heard ringing from other people's ears.
You have to put your ear up against the other person's ear.
It's a process. The technical term is an otoacoustic emission,
mm-hmm.
and it happens because our ears are able to selectively tune in to particular frequencies.
Oh, my God. That sounds like receiving transmissions.
Yeah, yeah. And think about it. If we're in a room, like at a party, and there's a lot of conversation going on, and we find, like, the person next to us starts talking about us, and we want to hear, like, what they're saying, we can tune in to
suddenly
their particular voice.
Suddenly we hear it.
and so in order to do that, the outer hair cells in our ear will vibrate at a particular frequency that then helps exaggerate or amplify that frequency coming from the environment. So, and when this happens with you, there's an aberrant. It's not normal to have that happen that loudly. And it is because the base of the brain in the pons, a part of the midbrain, is sending the signals inappropriately out to the outer ear just to start that process going.
Mm-hmm.
And when it comes, the cause of that could be many, many fold. Certainly,
maybe having a very small mother and a very big head.
It could be. It could be. And it could be the leg length, you know, difference that you talked about will create all kinds of different input into the brain, like we've been talking about so far in this show.
May I just describe, in parting, may I tell you what the final, who delivered the final blow?
Sure.
E. Lilly gave me 3.5 years of psychotic depression. I never was a manic depressive.
Mm-hmm.
I was a depressive, just like my dad. So what? You know, who's the corporate criminal?
All right, thank you very much, Amy. All right, let's go. Let me give you the numbers again. Our guest is Dr. James Otis. He is a chiropractor with special interest in neurology. We've talked with him extensively about a number of issues, learning difficulties, anxiety. We talked about balance and chronic pain. One more thing before we go to the next caller, who will be Paul in Livermore. Let me ask you about nutrition, where that fits into this, and if you've got some special tips for us on that and how that all integrates into balance.
Big time. And nutrition affects how our brain works. And so the brain needs to get a good fuel to it. And so, for example, sometimes people just feel dizzy or lightheaded a lot, and that could be from anemia. And if you're not getting enough blood up to your brain, your brain can't do its job, and people feel dizzy. And so that's an important thing to treat. And anemia can be from B vitamin deficiency, it can be from iron, it can be from iron deficiency, it can be a whole group of different things. One piece that I've been wanting to kind of get out on air is vitamin D and the importance of that and how much of a deficiency there is in our present society. We tend to be, how does that relate to balance? I'll start there. Vitamin D helps improve balance. It helps improve muscle strength. It helps improve endurance, all kinds of exercise abilities.
And where does it occur naturally?
Vitamin D naturally is made in our skin. And vitamin D is actually a hormone. And so it, as a hormone, it's in the steroid family of hormones, and it has a very powerful effect on how the genes in our body turn on and turn off. That's what all steroid hormones do. And when we're out in the sun, our body will generate vitamin D that then we use. And our bodies are hugely intelligent. They know how much vitamin D to make and when to shut it off. And so if we're out in the sun if somebody with light skin is out in the sun for about half an hour, just enough to get pink, just beginning to start to get pink, they will make about 20,000 IUs of vitamin D. And then once it gets past that, any more sun will start to degrade it. And so there's an automatic regulatory mechanism. And our bodies have that for every hormone. We need to be able to have enough, but not too much. And most of us at this latitude and doing the kind of indoor work that we do and not being out in the sun just simply do not get enough vitamin D. And it's especially true for people with dark skin because it takes much longer in the sun to generate the same amount of vitamin D as someone who has light skin. And so it's really interesting that common diseases associated with vitamin D deficiency include coronary heart disease, hypertension, diabetes, depression, cancer, especially breast cancer, prostate cancer, colon cancer, MS, big time. I can tell you so many stories about MS patients who come through and we get them on vitamin D and just they go into remission. They're so much better. All types of insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome, problems handling sugar, blood sugar, rheumatic diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, obesity, rickets, periodontal disease. And it's really interesting. All of these things that I mentioned here are more common in dark-skinned people than light-skinned people. And
You know, there's no question. There are a number of studies in the Bay Area to demonstrate that vitamin D deficiency is very, very common in the African American community in the Bay Area, and we've been trying to get the word out on that for quite some time. But I'm surprised, having been here for a number of years, to recognize that vitamin D is such an effective and necessary. I know it was effective and necessary, but I had no idea it was so critical.
Yeah. And let's talk, it's the standards are slow in terms of changing. Most labs, when I send people out for a lab study of how much vitamin D there is, are coming back with it. Their normal levels are much lower than I like to see. And what I like to see is a level of 40 to 65 nanograms per milliliter. And most labs will put like their sufficiency levels at 20 or something like that, so much lower. So that's the first thing, and it really I recommend it. Get that tested, and it won't cost more than $30, $35 to have it tested, and especially important in the winter. And in the winter, there's lower levels of vitamin. We don't have as much. The sun isn't as high. It won't generate as much vitamin D in our skin. And so all around the world, in the winter, you tend to get more depression. You tend to have more hypertension, more onset cancer onset at that time is a bit more serious. On and on and on. Babies that are conceived in the winter, in an area where the latitude is such that there's a big seasonal variation in terms of how much vitamin D is in the mom, those babies will have more learning difficulties than babies conceived in the summer, more autism rates, and you name it. And it's just, it's really...
Aren't there some evolutionary discussions about the importance of vitamin D as it relates to population motion and Caucasians in cold climates?
Yeah.
Because there's something about the absence of melanin in skin that enhances the... It either enhances or does something to the metabolism of vitamin D.
It makes it so that we produce more vitamin D when the UV light isn't being blocked out. Mm-hmm. And so a light-skinned person... So evolutionarily, people like migrated. We all began near the equator and then started to migrate north. And that's hard on a person physiologically because of lack of vitamin D. And I don't know. I mean, it would make sense to me that would tend to drive a lighter skin.
No, I've read some studies like that just to throw in the very bare minimum of anthropologic knowledge that I really have. Yeah. Let's go to Paul in Livermore. You're on About Health.
Hi, Paul.
Paul? Is he still there?
Paul?
Paul, it's
this
your...
This is Paul, yes.
All right, come on down. Your turn.
Hi, Dr. Lenore. Quite the wide-ranging discussion. And, boy, I'll tell you what, I've learned a lot. Anyway, I'm calling about my wife, who just recently has been suffering periodic episodes of imbalance. And she went to the doctor and... they said, well, a piece of calcium fell off your cochlea in your inner ear, and that's what's doing it, and it's going to rattle around in there for a while, and then it's going to eject or whatever. It'll get better. What do you think about that?
Paul, that's a very common scenario, and so it's called benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. And the mechanism behind that is that our balanced parts of our ear, there's little calcium carbonate stones that are hanging off of hair cells that when they sink in the gravity field.
Right.
And so if our head is upright, they'll be sinking in one way that stimulates a certain group of hair cells that then sends a message to our brain and we know which way is up. And if we have our head tilted to the side, a different group of hair cells are stimulated and we know that our head is tilted to the side. And... So sometimes those break loose, and the problem comes when they...
Oh, they're just hanging there all the time?
They're hanging there all the time, and
okay,
we need them.
Okay, I see.
And so it happens, and it's common that they break loose under two scenarios. One is that as a person gets older, they tend to break loose. Another is after head trauma, they tend to break loose. And I believe there's a big factor in calcium metabolism, in vitamin K physiology, which has to do with how calcium moves in the body. But I've noticed that some people tend to throw more of these stones than others. And the issue becomes when those stones get lodged in some of the semicircular canals, and they tend to get lodged in the posterior canal and a person, especially when they tilt their head back, will get vicious, the room spinning and that kind of stuff.
Right.
So there is very effective repositioning procedures, which I assume your wife has already been shown.
Well, she does go to a chiropractor, as a matter of fact, but for her collarbone that sticks out way more than the other one, and she works in the library, and you would think that library workers don't do manual labor, but boy, I'll tell you what, they do. You know, boxes of books.
Well, let me. I'd like to tell you just a little bit about some of these repositioning procedures.
Okay. That's why I'm calling, basically.
And you can look. What I would suggest is do a web search for benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, or BPPV. And there's often something called the Epley maneuver. Dr. Epley helped popularize some of these. And it involves putting your head in particular positions, a successive number of different positions that will help get the stones out of that posterior canal.
I see.
And it should provide very fast relief. Now, I want to also say, Paul, that many times that's an easy diagnosis that isn't actually what's happening. Because there can also be a part of the brain that receives the messages from the outer ear.
Well, I'm a pessimist, and I was hoping it was just a nice, easy thing like that. But
it might be. It might be.
But maybe if it is,
Paul,
much darker or whatever.
If it is brain tumor,
that sort of thing.
Yeah. If it is, you should. Your wife should get really good relief with the repositioning.
All right. Thank you very much for that call, Paul. Let's talk to Donna in Guerneville. You're on About Health. Donna.
Hello.
Hi. It's your turn.
Hi. My brother has some brain damage, and he's been on psychiatric medicines. And do you treat somebody like that?
Yes, I will.
And can I get your information, like phone number?
Yeah. Good. Great. Thanks. Go to my website, and it's www.jimotisdc.com. JIMOTISDC.com. And there's all kinds of information there in terms of how to contact me. I'll also give you my phone number in case you don't have internet access. 510-832-6848.
Okay, thank you.
Good,
thank you very
Donna.
Much. 848-4425 is our number. Dr. Jim Otis is our guest. He's a chiropractor with certainly an extensive in training and experience in neurology and the science of balance and a whole variety of healing techniques. And I think certainly broaden the range of chiropractic as a concept. If you want to join us, 510-848-4425, 848-4425. Let's go to Craig in Mid Pines. You're on About Health.
Hi. Very interesting discussion today. I'd like to save a minute at the end here to discuss my personal issue, which is healing from shingles. But before I get to that, I just want to say a couple of brief comments for the earlier caller. My heart really goes out to you, the one that had been hit in the head. I would say I've been paying close attention to what's been happening in Iraq with a lot of the soldiers there. There's been many cases of what is called traumatic brain injury, TBI, and it's possible you might be suffering from that. And also what you described also brought to mind PTSD. Don't dismiss that. It's very common, and you might in fact be suffering from both of those issues. And then the other brief comment is when you, for Dr. Otis, I was really glad that you brought up the connection between balance and learning disability. In particular, this has come up in connection with dyslexia. Now, there's been a lot of work. There's a lot of work being done on that in England. A lot of money being put into researching that, and I believe it's independent of chiropractic, so you know there seems to be confirmation for that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you want to comment on that quickly or before I go into my personal.
Yeah, I would. So one of the most common what we call comorbidities of a lot of types of learning issues, whether it's dyslexia or ADHD or any kind of thing are coordination issues. So a lot of these kids and or adults have difficulty moving their body in a smooth kind of way. And one of the best things, it's just really great to get them out on a trampoline, get them doing martial arts. There have been a lot of studies where that kind of movement, and we talked about this a little bit in terms of elderly people, but movement, motion, exercise is crucial for brain development, and especially for kids.
What about as you get older? I mean, you know, obviously everybody assumes that as you get older, you're going to start to lose brain function. Can exercise have that same impact?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I always make sure I do some something during the day that involves a little bit of balancing on one leg or the other.
Great, Craig. Me too. I do as well.
Okay, very quickly, Craig, you got a personal
issue. Yeah, you may recall Dr. Lenore, I called in a couple of months ago. I had just started suffering from shingles.
Right.
And it's been a long and very difficult process recovering. What I'd like to ask Dr. Otis, I did, in fact, go to see an acupuncturist. It helped at one point briefly, but then not so much. Anyway, right now what I'm really concerned about, I have made some real progress recovering from it, but it seems like I still have a long way to go here, even after 2 months. The skin part is mostly, you know, healed up, but there's still nerve issues. And so I'm concerned about what I can do to promote healing of the nerve, you know, if you have nutritional recommendations or anything else.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I do have some recommendations, and the first would be come see me. And what I would do, Craig, evaluate what's happening with your immune system. And we all have chronic virus in our body. And so you'll have this herpes virus that tends to cause shingles for the rest of your life. And it will tend to flare up or not under different kinds of stressful conditions. And the same is true for just we all harbor chronic viruses. And our immune system deals with it in a more or less effective way, depending upon a number of different factors, including calcium metabolism, how your immune system is working. So I would look closely at that.
All right. Thank you very much for that, Greg. Let's go to Mary in Pinole. You're on About Health. Is it May or Mary?
Hello?
Macy, I'm sorry.
Oh, thank you.
I wrote it down in doctor writing.
I figured Pinole was close enough.
All right.
I just wanted to ask the doctor a question, and maybe it was answered in part by his discussion on vitamin D. My husband and I live with and care for my grandfather, and as he ages, he's begun to experience what his physician calls miniature seizures. Mm-hmm. And it's always accompanied by nausea, definite balance issues. In fact, he loses pretty much control of everything below his hips, mm-hmm. and a lot of confusion. He's tried a lot of chiropractic work with anti-gravity, and he's also tried a series of injections with steroids for anti-inflammatory. His condition seems to be enhanced by a spinal stenosis, and I'm just wondering if there's a better way to treat perhaps the seizure as opposed to the symptoms that follow it that maybe we haven't heard about yet.
Mm-hmm. So, Macy, my first thought is I'd like to see your grandfather and, mm-hmm. and work with him. And so there could be so many different factors going on here. And certainly the constellation of balance issue and nausea, the balance center might be instigating some of this. There might be seizure activity higher in the brain, which is affecting the balance on the balance center. There could be a lot of different things going on here. But it's something that I'd be very glad to take a look at.
All right, give that information just in case.
And so, again, phone number 510-832-6848. And the website is www.jimotisdc.com. And Macy, did that answer your question?
I think
she's
was
gone. Okay. Great.
All right, let's go to Raul in Vacaville. You're on About Health.
Hi. 4 years ago, I donated 2/3 of my liver to my father. And I've had persistent pain ever since. I mean, it's just from the moment I woke up from surgery, it's just never gone away.
Okay.
And it's confined to one side. It's confined to my right side. It's mainly in my back, and I've tried just absolutely everything, and I just live off of pain pills. I've lost my job twice, and just it sucks.
And how long has this been since the surgery?
4 years.
4 years, okay. So, Raul, I want to get back to this in just a second, but I'm remembering one thing I wanted to say to Macy, the previous caller. And that is that, yes, I would suggest the vitamin D that does have anti-seizure effects in elderly. So, Macy, if you're still listening, go there. Okay, so, Raul, pain.
Yeah.
So if you've had pain and it's persisting for 4 years, I am guessing it's very high likelihood that the areas of your spinal cord and brain that register and inhibit pain from the right side of your ribcage, from the liver area, are wound up. It's a term that we call that they're firing too hard. And so what we'd want to do is to turn those down. And so the basic principle here is that in order for you to feel pain from any part of your body and from your, let's say, the right side of your ribcage, first there are nerve receptors in your ribcage that send a message to a nerve receptor in your spinal cord that in turn sends a message to a nerve receptor in the base of your brain that in turn sends a message to a nerve receptor in the top of your brain. And when it gets all the way up to the top, that's when you feel pain. And what happens after surgery or after any kind of injury, sometimes let me back up. At each step of the way, that there's a controlling mechanism that can either turn up or turn down the transmission of that pain signal farther into the nervous system. So in essence, we can decide to pay attention to it or not. And so when I was talking earlier with the woman who had been hit in the head, and I talked about how a brain injury can make it difficult, a person feels more pain, it's because they can't inhibit, they can't turn down these pain signals anymore. And so that has been, I can almost guarantee that's happening with you. And so then the trick is to find out.
I don't want to interrupt you too much.
Yeah.
I've tried just about everything. I went to the pain clinic. Mm-hmm. I've had steroid shots in my back. I've got a TENS unit. Mm-hmm. I've had lidocaine patches. I still take Neurontin and Norco. They tried really ramping up the Neurontin really high, mm-hmm. but I started twitching, and so they stopped doing that. I've tried so many things, mm-hmm. I go to the chiropractor. That helps a little, mm-hmm. but it's still, you know, a couple hours later, it's back, sometimes it never really leaves.
Yeah. So you might want to try somebody who's trained with chiropractic neurology, and let me tell you what would be different about that. The steroid injections, the lidocaine, all of those things, and most chiropractic are working on that first nerve receptor in the pathway, right out where it's actually hurting. And it takes, and sometimes acupuncturists and sometimes chiropractors and a whole group of other body, like somatic kind of healing arts, do affect what's happening in the spinal cord and the base of the brain. But not always. And the advantage of going to somebody who has a training in the neurology, is they can get a better sense of, you know, where is the wind-up problem and how to address it. It's just a fine-tuned approach to it. And so it might be helpful for you. If you'd like, contact me through the website, and I can find a referral for you in your area. And I would invite that invitation.
How many chiropractors are there with your training? I mean, this couldn't be that many.
No, there's about 400 worldwide, so not many.
All right. Well, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Let's go to Hacienda in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hello?
Yes, it's Hacienda.
Hi, I had a question about vitamin D.
Mm-hmm.
So what are options for supplementing vitamin D if you have that deficiency during the winter?
Take a form of vitamin D called vitamin D3. And a lot of the food that's fortified, like milk and that kind of thing, is vitamin D2. It's not as effective. Just look on the label. It should say vitamin D3. And for most people, 4,000 IUs a day is good.
But, okay.
And monitor it with your blood work.
Mm-hmm. And then I had another question. I was wondering if you could talk any more about the sound work that you mentioned earlier.
Okay. The sound work. I would go back to Raul. And that is, I've used the sound very effectively for people who have post-operative knee pain, like 4 years after an operation and that type of thing. And again, what we're using the sound for is to help activate and balance the areas in the base of the brain. And so some of the technology that I'm using there with the sound are a technology called binaural beats, which involve putting, it's all computer-generated sound that's through headphones that puts one tone in one ear and a different tone in the other ear. And if the two tones going into the two ears are, let's say 7 hertz or 7 cycles per second different, slightly different pitches, then the brain will hear that and hear that a 7 hertz beat, and it'll go wah, 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 wah. You'll hear that, like, subjectively, you'll experience that. And what ends up happening neurologically as a result of that is that the two sides of the brain are coordinated. They come into synchrony. And this is a coherence is another term for it. And this is a very distinct style of neurological functioning that is very important. So, and what it facilitates is a right to left cooperation in the brain. So our brains are designed to, you got me started here, so I'll go a little bit more. It's something I'm very interested in. Our brains need to be, the two sides of our brain serve different functions. And they are complementary to each other. They need to be able to work independently, and they also need to be able to cooperate. It's like any relationship. And so the two people need to be able to cooperate, and we need, in some situation, have one side take the lead and the other side follows, and in another situation, have the other side take the lead. Side B take the lead and side A follows. And so the sound technology helps to facilitate that in a very effective way.
All right, thank you very much. Let's try to get Corinne in. You're on About Health.
I'm here.
Okay.
Okay, I have a 14-year-old daughter. Whenever she gets a fever, she has a hallucination, and it's she acts incredibly violently during these things. She will try and, a normally very cautious child, she will try to run out the door, she will try to break glass. She's a different person. When it comes to balance, the last time that it happened, and this only happens when she has a fever, she actually just collapsed a couple of times. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to know, I've done some research online. The closest thing I could come to was epilepsy. I have an appointment coming up with a neurologist, but every doctor that I've talked to up until this point has just thought I was nuts. So I'd like to know if you've heard anything like this.
Not exactly, but I've heard similar stories of people, and when they get fevers, having, you know, whatever, more susceptible to seizures or more susceptible to I have hallucinations. That is something I've heard of. So I think a couple different things, Karina. One is I would look at what's triggering the fevers, you know, help look at immune system function. And then the other thing I'd look at is what's happening neurologically, because there is some kind of neurological predisposition that the fever is then activating.
So I
would be glad to work with your daughter and or refer you to somebody who has similar training.
Now, you know what happens, though, is that there's a wide range of reactions to fever, Karina. Children generally tend to react in predictable ways, but I know a number of children who will hallucinate pretty quickly with fevers, and generally these are thought to be rather innocent episodes. So while you might want to pursue it a little bit more in detail, don't be too confused or too concerned, I'm sorry, about that. Because I do see a lot of that as a pediatrician. Well, Dr. Otis, wow, the time has gone back by so fast, I don't know that I even had time to get in balance.
I really enjoyed being here.
No, we want to thank you for joining us. You will be back again. We weren't able to get to all the questions, but we do want to thank you for taking the time. I'd like to thank the Ethical Institute for the opportunity they give me every week to come and share my time with KPFA on KPFA. But most of all, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to join us. Another edition of About Health. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. Next week, acupuncture. We'll talk again.
Dr. Michio Kaku, physicist and host of Exploration. Every Tuesday at 2 p.m., we discover the fascinating world of science, discussing black holes, the search for intelligent life in the universe, DNA technology, global warming, the Star Wars program, and many more. We cover the scientific breakthroughs which will affect our lives, health, safety, and our role in the universe. So join us every Tuesday afternoon from 2 to 3 p.m. as we explore the cosmos together.